Public lecture. Today's lecture is titled "How do scientists predict the weather?" So you know this question, prediction of the weather is important to every citizen, starting from the farmer who will be thinking about sowing the seed to a rocket scientist planning to launch the satellite. And in India, especially if you are a cricket fan, prediction of the weather matters a lot for you. We asked some children how scientists predict the weather. They said it is very easy. Just look at the satellite image, see the clouds, then say rain will come or not. But I don't think it is very that much easy. And today we will hear the details of prediction of the weather from a scholar practitioner, Professor Shailesh Naik, our beloved director. A few words about this speaker. Professor Naik is the current director of National Institute of Advanced Studies and distinguished scientist in the Ministry of Earth Sciences. He was the chair, Earth System Science Organization, ESSO, and the secretary to the Government of India for Ministry of Earth Science between August 2008 to 2015. He provided leadership for the programs related to science of climate change, weather services, polar science, geoscience, ocean science, ocean survey, resources and technology, and the development of a tsunami warning system. Dr. Naik was responsible for the conceptualization and development of marine GIS. Dr. Naik is the chair, National SCAR Committee, Indian National Science Academy, ULP, Research Advisory Committees of the CSIR, National Environmental Engineering Research Institute, Nagpur, ESSO, National Antarctic and Ocean Research Center, Goa, and Defence Terrain Research Laboratory, Delhi. President of the Federation of Indian Geoscientists Association, Indian Geophysical Union, Indian Society for Remote Sensing, and Indian Mandu Society. So, over to you, sir.
Thank you, Vinay, for a very kind introduction. And I think what you mentioned about the student, it also says how satellites are important in the weather forecasting today. Before starting, I must confess that I'm not expert on the weather forecasting per se, but I know how they do it. I have never done it, but I know how they do it. So this may be a good occasion for me also, that how well I can communicate to you what are the issues involved in the forecasting. Now, what exactly is the forecasting? The weather forecasting as we define is our knowledge about the Earth system. That means the atmosphere, ocean, snow and ice, the biological forest, and the other aspects. So normally we think weather is only atmospheric phenomena, but it is not so. It is a combination of various interactions, which I will come slightly later. And the second is the technology. As the technology improves, our forecasting also has been improving. And I will explain you how it is. Now, once we have the knowledge about the processes which are undergoing, then we would be able to give certain prediction for a given region or any particular location for a certain period of time. Now this is what call is the weather forecasting. Now actual formal weather forecasting started in 19th century in England, but informal weather forecasts were made even earlier. I mean, even since civilization started, there are mentions of the weather forecast. We'll come back to that slightly later. Now, once we want to know the information about, that means we need to observe the quantitative data on the various aspects like atmosphere, ocean, land surface, which we do through certain instruments. Now, these instruments could be placed on land, could be on ocean, could be on aircraft, or could be on balloon, could be on satellites. Now, using all we observe and our knowledge about the various processes and the development of various models, we project that what is likely to happen or how the present atmosphere is likely to change over a time. Now, the first informal So, if you see the, even in our Vedic times, you will find the mention of weather forecast. Even one of the very important thing which there are a lot of mention about rain modification or weather modification, how the rainfall can be generated. And probably that time that could be a major issue. I mean, they were depending on rainfall for all their need, and there could be a droughts. But there are mentions of how the rainfall can be also generated. In Babylonians also they had certain weather mainly on the cloud patterns. Aristotle has the treatise which is called Meteorologica around 350 years before Common Era. Chinese also around more or less same time has certain developed methods. Now, all these methods essentially relied on the observations, I mean, human observations, and they were limited. I mean, they were able to see only a small area where essentially what they can see is a cloud, whether wind is there or not, or whether there are different colors in the sky. They were very peculiar. One line is the reddish tinge in the evening or the night, and that normally it will taken as a sign for rains. Essentially, when you see reddish, it is very highly humid climate, and there is a possibility of rain. So there were few things which they observed were also very accurate, but at the same time, it didn't stand to present day scientific scrutiny. I mean, statistically, they were not very reliable, and most of the time, this forecast cannot be used, I mean, the way they were made in the present circumstances. In 19th century, the actual first weather daily forecast was published with the Times in 1861. And there are many people, but I think just two people, the Beaufort and the Fitzroy, they laid actually the founding of the scientific forecasting. Now, why I mentioned technology, that the telegraph, which were also came around 1985, which allowed to collect data from a large area, and this continued for more than 100 years, that the different places, the observation instruments were kept, and they will record at different times, and they will send telegram to the central office, and they will combine all the data to make the forecast. Of course, not very efficient, but this was being used even in 30, 40 years back, till satellites came. This was the standard practice of collecting large amount of data. And before, basically developed various meteorological parameters, characterization, like what is the wind. We say wind is high or low, but we characterized into different scales, and then different notation that what kind of weather and how we will depict them, the what tides is likely to come at different times. And the Robert basically dealt with the collection of data and sort of an office how to communicate to mariners. At that time, the main requirement came from the Navy of the weather, because most of the work done through a ships, both the strategic security as well as the trade, were through the ships. So the marine nurses were very keen to have the forecast. And when the photography came, again it became easier to record various observations. So while the technology developed, in the same way, our understanding about the meteorology improved and the forecast also improved. Now, this, why the earlier thing never functioned properly is, now we know that when you want to give a forecast for the weather, you need a global data. And why do you need a global data? Because there is a constant interaction happening between the different components of the Earth. Now, we define a five major components of the Earth. One is, of course, atmosphere. Second is the hydrosphere or ocean. This also includes the rivers and other things. Then we have a snow and ice, or what we call as a cryosphere. Then the geosphere, or the land surface. What is the land use, vegetation? What is the topography or orography? And the biosphere, or the vegetation. Now, there is a constant interaction of both the mass and the energy between this component, among the component, and within the component. And this essentially defines what happens in the weather. Like if I give a small example of a monsoon, we know that when the ocean heats up, the water starts evaporating and it will form a cloud. Because of the wind, the cloud will travel to the land and the rain will fall on the land, and this rain gets into rivers, and then essentially the water again goes back to the ocean. So what we call as a hydrological cycle, this is in a very simple term, but this kind of changes, mass and energy exchanges, happens continuously across the globe. So when we want to give a forecast for weather, we need information about all aspects. That means we need information about the atmosphere, we need information about ocean, we need information about land surface, we need information about snow and ice. So all these information is required to give a prediction. Now, today, because we have aircraft, satellites, and the in-situ observations, we have been able to collect the information throughout the globe. And there is extremely good communication system. So what called as the WMO, the World Meteorological Organization, has a global telecommunication system. So all the countries share the data of their country for the global use, and they are used in the different models. Now we will see some of those things, how the observations are made, because the most important is the observations, which will lead to understanding about the processes, and these processes are modeled, and then these models give you the prediction. So the process starts with the observations. Now there are a variety of instruments which are placed in different places. This is on the land, and don't worry about the kind of instrument, but basically you measure temperature, dew point, wind speed, wind direction, what is the rainfall, what is the cloud cover, at what height the clouds are there, what is the pressure, what is the visibility. All these informations are continuously collected. Now, slowly we have been shifting to mostly automatic weather stations, and they have a satellite linked data collection platforms. So they collect the data and continuously transfer the information. So almost in a real time, you get the information about from throughout the world. when the manned stations are there, you have to use the other communication means to transmit the data. But in these also, the many places now slowly being replaced by the automatic weather stations. Now, this gives only the surface observations. But as the you know the atmosphere, you need information about the entire column of the atmosphere. So what is launched is the, what we call as the radio sonde. It's a balloon with the instruments, and it travels upwards as it goes up, and it is tracked at different height, what was the temperature, pressure and all other parameters, and what is its position, because whenever you launch, it will also drift because of the wind. So in each measurement, you need its geographic positions and the altitude. So this is possible now with GPS. This has become much more simpler. Also, sometimes the other is the drop sonde. That means you drop the instruments from the aircraft and it will travel from top to bottom. So both kinds of systems are used to get the information about the atmosphere. Also, the aircraft also travels throughout the globe. And most aircraft also carries instruments. And they continuously measure, and this information is also transferred to the concerned agencies. Now, ocean is very critical because 70% of the area is ocean, and you need information about the ocean. So you can see on the right hand side what we call as a buoy, and this kind of buoys are installed in the ocean, which measures the atmospheric parameters as well as the ocean parameters like the sea surface temperature, currents, etc., and the atmospheric parameters like temperature, wind and the pressure and all. So this is very important, of course, to deploy such buoys and to manage is a very, very difficult task, and very few countries in the world have this kind of buoys, and India is one of them, which we have the buoys deployed in both the Bay of Bengal and in the Indian Ocean, and also on the tropical sea, which we do along with the US. There are a new large number of different kinds of buoys which measure a variety of things over a period of time. And the other important is the satellites. After the 1957, the Sputnik was launched, the first satellite in 1960, PIROS, was the meteorological satellite. They realized the importance of the satellite. And today, if you have three satellites in geosynchronous orbit, that means 36,000 kilometers above the Earth, then you get entire information of the globe at the same time. This is something very, very useful, because earlier you were never getting the information about the entire Earth at the same time. So this satellites made very, very dramatic change. And there are many kinds of satellites now, we will come back to that. But these satellites first time really give the global coverage, both ocean and land. So this is very, very important. And next is the radars, weather radars, which also are very critical for us to get the information about various meteorological parameters. Now, this is the kind of observations in the first left-hand side image is the observations which are land or ocean-based information. You can see there are thousands of observations. It is more than 60,000 observations which come daily from variety of the agencies. The second, you can also see in this that the Africa, the large part of Africa is not at all observed. So this is one of the major lacuna which we have. Even the both the Arctic and Antarctic are also not adequately observed. So this is the limitation of the ground-based systems, where you have in Europe and US, you can see very high density, while in the other areas, it's very low density. So this is one issue which we have to resolve when you want to use this information. The second is the information which is generated by the radio sonde, that is the balloons which we send up. Again, you can see that Africa and even Latin America and large part of Canada doesn't have, or even Australia doesn't have this kind of a system. So very large gap in our profile of the columnar information about temperature and humidity in the atmosphere. And the third bottom, you can see this is the information which is coming from the aircraft. Each aircraft has the instruments, and our Indian, and they all share the data with each other. So, but you can see that the amount of information is more. Where the large number of aircrafts are flying. So you can see that Europe, again US, and the Southeast Asia, Australia, are heavily a large amount of data, but there are large areas which do not have any observations. So this is mainly the in-situ observations which we get. Now, satellite, there are many agencies in the world, like USA, what we call as NOAA, Korean Meteorological Agency, China Meteorological Agency, ISRO, Europe has a EUMETSAT. So all these collect large amount of data. And the DWR is a weather radars, which is used that also provide data, and GTS, the Global Telecommunication System. So roughly about 450 GB data from the entire globe comes for the assimilation, for which the based on which the predictions are made. So it's a very huge amount of data, and after the satellite came, the data became very large. Earlier, when the satellites were not there, the data was very small, and smaller computers were able to use. So, but at the same time, the computers started coming in 50s, and the satellites also came. So the large computing power also helped immensely for the weather forecast. We will see this slightly later on also. Then there are large number of information about the land surface. I am not showing all each and everything, some few examples. The soil moisture is one of the very important category which is changing. So, and this gets into the global models. And this is, of course, I have shown only India just to give you an idea. But this kind of analysis is done for the entire globe. And this is, they use certain satellite data and then again model and generate the soil moisture conditions over the entire globe. You need information about the cryosphere, so snow cover, also sea ice, land ice. All this information is continuously collected and they will be assimilated into the models. So large amount of, I mean, don't worry about the what we do, but it is the surface observations which comes from land, the synoptic measurements, ships, buoys, like aircraft. Each ship also carries the weather instruments, and they also continuously provide. Then the sondes, aircraft, and the satellites. So there are large amount of data, which variety of satellites. There are microwave, infrared, hyperspectral, the navigation satellites, the low Earth orbit satellites, the geostationary satellites. There are scatterometers which provide the winds, altimeters, which provide you sea level. So large amount of data comes routinely for assimilation into the models. Now, how they are all integrated? You can see that the all global observations which comes from different places, so you need a very robust communication system. And so all observations are comes to the main central, and then their processing happens. Now, the first level processing, because you have to ensure the quality, you have to checks and balances are there. So, what? Because all the data which comes not automatically get into models. We only use those data which certain level of standards we pass through, and then it is being used. And then the models do the analysis. I'll come back slightly later on the models. And then the forecast is given. This forecast are different types, in the sense it could be a different resolutions. If you 5 days short term forecast, it could be 10-day forecast, it could be seasonal forecast. So there are different kinds of forecasts are generated, and then it goes to the users. Now, in this century, I mean last 50 years or so, the prediction has been depending more on the numerical methods. So this is what because we now understand the various atmospheric processes much better, how they interact with the ocean or how they interact with the snow and ice. So this have become the understanding about this has improved. And this prediction actually started in 1955 first time. Basically, what is in this numerical method is there are equations of fluid dynamics and the thermodynamics. So the current state of fluid is observed, and using these equations, they try to estimate what would be the state of fluid after some time. And this observation is continuously being done into this. Now, this is very complex. Actually, these codes are millions of lines, and I'm not going to explain this, but this is the crux of the problem. And once the model starts analyzing, it will predict next one. And meanwhile, the observations are continuously fed into it till the information what you desire, that thing, what would be the atmosphere after 5 days, or what would be the atmosphere after 1 day, or what would be atmosphere after 4 months or 3 weeks. So there are different time scales. And as you increase the time scale, like seasonal forecast which we gave, you cannot give a seasonal forecast for a very small area, like say Bangalore. But if you want to give a forecast for a Bangalore, you can give very accurate forecast for the next 24 hours or next 5 days. But if you can't give with the same forecast after 3 months or 4 months. But for India as a whole, you can give a very good forecast of a monsoon. So there are different time scales, and the space scales would be different for the different forecasts. And the changes in the models and the equations and the codes are also changed accordingly. Now, what we use is a global models, which is essentially originally from US and UK Met Office. And these have been now changed. The physics and all have been modified to suit our requirement. So they give the short-term forecast for 5 days. Then there are ensemble forecasts. What they do is they change the initial conditions. And then they run the 20 times, 30 times, and then they try to put them together. I will show you some examples. Then they try to give that this could be the likely weather. Because basically it is all probability that what is likely to happen. So you try to do as best as possible and reduce the uncertainties as far as possible. And then there are very high resolution models, what we call as the weather research forecasting, is give you 3 kilometer, 9 kilometer, you know, very high resolution models, which is essentially used for the regional forecast. And then the local forecast is also given, like for a particular city or a particular block, you can give a local forecast as well. So there is a general forecast, and then the regional offices, the local offices use those information, see the what is local conditions, and then give the forecast. Now, the performance, normally people believe that, you know, the forecasts are by and large wrong, but it is not so, you know, and everybody says that when I went to Europe or when I went to US, the forecasts were very good, but our forecasts are not very good. So you can see that the skill at what we have been doing, now we have more or less same skill as UK and US. Only Europe is far ahead of everyone, even today. About one day, they do 5-day forecast also much better than what others do. But up to 3 days, the forecasts are more or less of the same time. Now, to achieve this, we had to do large amount of investment in everything. The first is observations. As I mentioned, the amount of observations we improved in last 10 years from 40 GB to 400 GB per year, per day. So that was the one major. Then when you take large amount of data, you need different techniques, what we call as assimilation techniques. Because these observations are coming at different locations. Now the models as grids, you know, 3 kilometer grid or 20 kilometer or any grid. So all these observation has to be fixed into particular grid. So that is, in a very simple terms, this is called an assimilation. So we had to do this, and when you have a large amount of data to be processed, you need a very high powered computers, and we have now almost 8 petaflops of computing available, so this could be all processed. At the same time, various research studies, nationally, internationally done, to understand the various processes and how these processes can be represented into the models. So there is a lot of work done on that. And the most important is you need to develop people who can run those models. So we had the special training schools to train the people for this. And today, our forecasts are as good as anybody else. Now, Binoy mentioned that the many people, you know, there are today, there is not any sector which doesn't need a weather forecast. Of course, the general people, the public, because they want to know whether to take an umbrella when you go out or not, or whether you should take a raincoat or whatever. So heat waves, cold waves, pollution, all these forecasts are given today. Then agriculture is very important for the crop, especially various farm operations. And that is the another way. Aviation, especially turbulence, both during takeoff and landing, as well as when they are cruising, about the jet stream, what are the headwinds, tailwinds, because then based on that, they would be able to decide that what time they will reach, whether they have to change the course a little bit to avoid the headwind. So all sort of things are aviation. Marine also, they, apart from wind and speed, they also need to know wave and currents, tides. Forest fire, you know, now it has become very important. You must be all reading in California, in Australia, even in India, in Uttarakhand and all. The forest fires have become a real serious issue. And most, it is not necessary that it is happening because of some person's carelessness, but lot of lightning. In California, it happened because of lightning, and it was so dry a climate, and because of that, the forest fire started. So, this you need information that beyond certain temperature, wind, and humidity conditions, whether the forest fire is likely to happen or not. And of course, it is not that easy to take any preventive measures, but I think the people are trying to find that if it is likely to, if we know well in advance, whether we can take any steps. The various utility companies, you know, like power, during if summer is going to be very hot, then the AC requirement will increase. If winter is also going to be very cold, then also power requirement goes up. And this is continuously monitored. Even in India, all power companies continuously monitor the weather and estimate. They have their own models to estimate that what would be the requirement. The commercial companies also, like what would be, depending on season, if it is going to rainy, the people may think that the cup and all those kind of things will be more required. The raincoat umbrellas will be required if it's dry. Then. So each and everybody uses this information. And of course, there are a large amount of military applications, if you will not go into the details. I will quickly, I have some time. Okay. I'll give you some examples of this. Now, what we saw is a basic forecast. But when you want to use for a specific purpose, it is has to be customized for that purpose. Now, this is one which is in India, we have what we call as agrometeorological advisories. And this is very useful where the farmers are provided information about the rainfall, maximum minimum temperature, cloud cover, humidity and the wind for next 5 days. Now, this is important for them for farm operations. That means whether to apply fertilizer or pesticides or whether when they should harvest, because if they apply the pesticides and if it is going to rain, then everything will be washed off. So they will lose the money. So they need to know that what is likely to happen next 5 days. And this is now very widely provided to the farmers. Actually, 40 million farmers are routinely using this and on the mobile. Also, it given in the local vernacular language. And this is very useful because they found the National Council for Applied Economic Research found that those farmers, they assume that 93% of farmers today are now using the weather forecast. And the annual benefit to the country is about $10 billion. So it's a huge benefit comes if you use the information about the weather in the various farm operations. Similarly, a lot of flood level and whether the flood forecasting. So CWC routinely uses the information what is called as a quantitative precipitation forecast. That means it is they've been provided that next 72 hours the rainfall will be 5 centimeter, 2 centimeter, 1 centimeter, whatever it is, in a different place, in a state-wise, district-wise, watershed-wise. So they can compute that how much rain is likely to come, contribute to a flood. So mainly based on this, the flood forecast is given, and also different kinds of products generated. Daily it is generated that what was the rainfall, where we merge both satellite and the observed data to useful, provide them use in the various hydrometeorological services. This is the example of the Uttarakhand in Kedarnath when it happened. The first forecast was given 3 days before, 72 hours before. And you can see these red and orange, which shows that the rainfall could be more than 20 centimeter, which is called extremely heavy rainfall. And this was further upgraded. Day two, you can see how the system has become stronger. And day one, when it started raining, the system slowly started dissipating. And there were two kinds of forecasts, as I explained. Regional, that they will say that the thunder showers occur Himachal and Uttarakhand. But the local, they will say rain thunder showers in Jyotirmad, Badrinath, Kedarnath, Yamunotri and Gangotri. And they also mentioned Chardham Yatra advised to be postponed for next 3 days. So this, but the problem was how to communicate. In many of our regions, this has not reached, and where it has reached, people thought it may not be correct, you know, because back of our mind, we always make a joke, like Lakshman famous, that if the forecast is a rain, then he won't carry umbrella. If there is a dry, then he will carry umbrella. So, in back of our mind, that the forecast is not going to be correct. And many, all you know what all happened, so I don't have to. But the forecast was available. So, many times it is not necessary that the forecast is available, that means we would be able to say. There are three aspects which have to be always keep in mind. One is the knowledge about what is likely to happen. The second is what is the response of the government to that knowledge. That means what steps government is taking to make some resilience against those likely events. And the third, the consciousness of the people. And mostly I have seen in our country that when the rainfall forecast is given, people do not take it seriously. When we give cyclone forecast, people assume that it will come and it is going to damage. And that's why last several years you see there is hardly any loss of life, so maybe 10, 12. But we miss it. But when we gave a forecast of a heavy rainfall after the cyclone, because normally after cyclone it will be followed by heavy rainfall, we have seen that 60 to 80 people die. Because people think that the worst is past and now nothing to worry. So the consciousness of the people is equally important. So you need all the three aspects for the... So it is not necessary, any one of the component is not functional, then the forecast, even if it is given good forecast, it may not be useful. So this also we should keep in mind. And then, you know, this is at a very broad scale, but now the forecast we give at a city level, like Chennai flood. Of course, this was simulated later on. After the Chennai had a flood, we improved our system for flood forecasting. So all the rainfall forecast and the hydrological model, the inundation models, have been, everything have been combined. And now the ward-wise inundation is given. That this ward, this much inundation is likely to happen. So as the technology improves, the information also could be much better. And now similar system is also being placed in Bombay. So slowly I think we all cities would have this kind of a system where ward level information would be provided. In North India, the fog is very critical, especially during winter seasons. And this is very routinely given. Also, this is very useful for the aviation. You must have noticed now that if there is a fog forecast, the flights are not allowed to be taking off from a particular airport. Because if they reach there and there is a fog, then there is a problem. So once they know that the fog is likely to clear at 11, then from Bangalore, the flight will be allowed to take off only after 9 o'clock. So that when they reach, there is no problem. And then they schedule that the how many flights are coming. So each flight, so now you must have seen that the delays in aircraft has increased. But where it has become a problem now, in railways. Because railways, still there is no operational system to use the folk forecasting for railway operations. Because it was believed that railways won't be any problem, but unless they can't see the signal, they can't move. So now the system is being made for the railways also, so that they can, or highways. Now each transport, the fog has become very critical, and the separate system, customized forecast, now on the each toll, the information would be available whether there is a going to be fog, and if it is going to be fog, up to what distance the fog is likely to be there. This is city specific. So each city, more than 500 cities now, you can get very good forecast for 24 hours, up to 5 days. And also in few cities where we have radar, what we call as a now cusping, that is what is going to happen next 6 hours to 24 hours is also provided. And along with what is likely air quality also is being provided for the certain cities where the air quality instruments are placed. So there are different kinds of forecasts. Of course, the basics still remain same, but they are customized to make use for the specific customer. So there are many, now the routine forecasts are given for Amarnath Yatra or Chardham Yatra, and where people walk for a long distance and it takes long time. The heliport services for Juhu, Vaishno Devi, because the helicopters are very sensitive to weather, especially those who have gone to Shillong and all. You will find that after 2 p.m., no flights will take off because suddenly the clouds will come and you can't do anything. So when exactly this is going to happen? So this kind of forecast for helicopter also has been started. Also the wind farms, they have to generate a certain amount of power at what they have committed for next 5 days. So they need to know what kind of a wind is going to be there. Now they need wind at 80 meter, right? This wind which we generate at the surface level. So this has to be converted into a 80 meter. So, but this is now all wind farms routinely use this weather forecast. Also, there are reservoirs. This is Bakra Bias, and my most reservoirs also like to know what is likely water going to come for next week, so that they know when to open the gates or not. So like that, there are, even for nuclear power corporation, very high resolution for wind, humidity. Suppose there is an accident, then in which direction the radiation is likely to move, because the, so that also has been routinely done, and this is done every day without fail. That this, so I have not listed all, but there are so many for solar farms. Everywhere the weather forecast is now major input. Now the monsoon, I'll just take 2 minutes, because the earlier monsoon predictions were not good, and as I showed you, the main thing was that the kind of computing power which is required and the models required, because rain forecast was not based on the model earlier. So we set up the state-of-art dynamical model system and high performance computing system. So all this together, we made the monsoon forecast much better. This is the onset of monsoon is very critical. And where the various things are taken, the satellite, the provides the outgoing long wave radiation, which essentially tells you about clouds, the winds, what is the water vapor, what is the different winds at the different heights. All this information is used to give the onset of monsoon. And you must have seen that the onset of monsoon predictions are pretty good. With plus minus 3 days, it has been always happening. You must have all heard about El Nino and ocean dipole. These are the very important phenomena which is useful in the monsoon. And this is a very high resolution model. Then this is ensemble which I was telling. you can see several lines, and then the mean line is picked up for what is likely to happen. So many 40, 50 members, you do it, and then they give a prediction for El Nino and ocean dipole, and these are integrated into the monsoon forecast. So this is now the improvement which has happened over a period of time. This, of course, example I have taken for 14, because it was below normal, and normally it is more difficult to predict below normal, and it is very essential to predict below normal monsoons, because then you can take adequate care. This year the monsoon was predicted normal and above normal, and you must have all seen that it happened exactly like this. So you can see that the forecast has improved, except in one case, Northeast India, there are some issues. But other than that, the forecast has been extremely good. We have also now done not only once, but the forecast is given three times in a season, so that if there are any changes to be made, that can be made. Both the monthly forecast as well as the region-wise forecast are extremely good now. Also, there is a need to give a forecast 3 to 4 weeks in advance. And this is also now done very well. And you can see that the forecast and the observations are matching extremely well. So this is what we call as the active and break cycle. Now, this is very important, where the active cycle is there and when the break is going. So break, normally in some regions, you may need to provide irrigation. If you reach more than 1 month in advance, then the active or break cycle becomes useful. So this is also now the break cycle. And once you have the information about the rainfall, can be also converted along with the other parameters, like the area which has been sown, what is the condition, what is the soil moisture, and where the drought. So this is routinely done now, the drought assessment, each district-wise, that where likely to be a drought. The cyclone also needs a lot of information, and last several years, you can see that we were dead right in all the cyclone predictions. It uses, starts with the sea surface temperature. And the cyclone forecast improve off the satellite, because we get the entire information about the ocean. And then what is the sea level height? What is the temperature at the depth at 26 degree temperature? Because about 27 degree, the, normally there is a possibility of a cyclone forming. And what is the total heat potential? So based on all this, this is again put into a whole model, and then forecast is given. You can see now forecast has been extremely good, you know, all along the track, and the landfall points have been provided extremely good. The 4 days before the landfall is given is about 40 kilometers, and 1 day before is about 10 kilometers. So we know exactly when the cyclone is going to be. So evacuation and all becomes very easy. At the same time, this cyclone forecast is, we provide not only to India, but all countries into Bay of Bengal and Arabian Sea, because India is the regional center for the World Meteorological Organization. And along with cyclone, you also need to provide what is the storm surge. That means how high the water will go and what are the areas will be covered. So this also you can see that the inundation extent, which is also provided, and you can see in the bottom how well they match with the actual observations. Also in the sea, there will be many ships, and you don't need to know what could be the height and the currents, and this information also is now provided, so that all ships, and they know that what they are going to expect during cyclone. And lastly, you know, we also need to know the climate is changing, and we need to know what is the shift. The climate state, what will happen in 2050, 2060. So this model is also have been perfected, and now we are participating in this
IPCC forecast. Our Indian model is also giving a forecast that we use. So this is the model which is and then for us the monsoon is very critical. So what we found that the rainfall, the events which would be less and the increase in heavy precipitation, events of the heavy precipitation increase. So this is also at the climate scale also we are ready. And lastly, I mean, basically I would like to conclude by saying that the advance which has happened in last couple of decades is essentially because of our understanding about the Earth system, the observations which are provided by the satellites along with the computing power and the communication power, both has increased, which helped us to give very reliable and accurate weather information. Now, this is not all, but we need to continue to sustain and integrate these observations. There are, we need some new observation, especially as I mentioned, the wind. We don't have the wind at a different level, that is wind profile in the atmosphere. So that is one area which we need to continue to work. And now we have a particular 5 to 7 days in advance for the from the global models, the regional high models for 1 to 3 days. And now casting, which is being doing based on the weather radars and the satellite and up some high resolution models, 3 kilometers up to 6 hours. So all different levels we have been now able to give forecasts. With this, thank you very much for this opportunity. Thank you, Vinay.
Thank you, sir, for a very interesting lecture. And now we know that the 2 minute or half minute segment after each news bulletin, the complexity behind that. So they just say whether this must be this time, this must be at this city, but you know the complexity of work and effort put to generate that information. Thank you very much. Now the floor is open to the open for the questions.
Thank you, sir.
Hello. Hello.
Carry on, Rudram.
Professor Nayak, this is Rudrodip from your institute, sir. It was very enriching presentation, and I am very very enriched after hearing to you for about an hour, sir. I have one philosophical question about the numerical prediction that you mentioned. There are two different philosophies. One is that you increase your computation power and put all the brute force to solve detailed solution. Another thing is that based on adequate resolution and adequate computational power, not too high end, but somewhere in between, you do reasonably accurate prediction and you make your computational job faster. So, sir, I work in energy sector, and there we have very effective reduced order models that you just passing remark you mentioned, and it is a very high amount of research is required to know what actually is reduced order model for each of the field. So, do you feel that there are enough reduced order model in the atmospheric sciences, or we need more detailed model and more computation power? What is your philosophical take on that?
Yeah, I mean, thank you. My philosophy is slightly different in the sense that there are two aspects which we need to understand. The first is whether we have understood the process, because many agencies run models. You have a computing power, you run a model at 1 kilometer also, no problem, for the global. But whether the understanding of the processes at that accuracy, whether we have understood, or it is more of a general, whether we can validate those models, that means whether I have
a 1 kilometer model. That means I have understood whatever process is going on in that, and I have sufficient observations for that model. Otherwise, the model will, if you have a power, you can run at any resolution. That's not a problem. But my feeling is we should understand the physics, and depending upon our understanding of the physics, we should run model at that resolution. So global models, we did not run at a very high resolution, but the regional and the local high-end models, you can run at a high resolution. So it will save energy, and it will be more accurate also, because it's not that higher resolution means it's more accurate. We have seen in many cases that the medium resolution models predict better than very high resolution, because what you want to predict, whether it is a mesoscale feature or it's a local, you know, there are several aspects which need to consider before you decide this. So I don't think we need to have any specific philosophy, but in short, understand the processes and phenomena, and accordingly you configure your model.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Yes.
Sai Baba.
Yeah, thank you, Professor Naik, for this perspective. But I was just thinking, the way the data is becoming crunched, do you foresee an individual role in prediction, or is it just that everything is data and then automation? And where do you foresee the role of humans in the end? Are we moving away from it?
No. Actually, the forecast which is given, it is the human decision ultimately. It is not that whatever model forecast they automatically gets circulated. Actually, the actual forecaster collects outputs for more than one model, or sometimes the ensemble and all that different aspects, and then he gives his forecast. So the human only thing has changed is that he is now much better equipped with the information based on which he will give a forecast. Earlier, they were giving forecast only on synoptic observations, so which will come through a telegram, and there are charts they will be making. Somebody will make charts, and then they will see the chart, and then now this has become a lot of automation, lot of observations. So you need, but still, you know, the ultimate, you know, like a very famous case during Hudhud, you know, our forecasters believed that, and our models also said that it would be not more than 220 kilometer. And the American forecast were almost 300 kilometer. That's what they were doing. And there was a lot of confusion in the government, because whether to believe IMD or whether to believe them. And our minister was Jaipal Reddy, and I requested him to talk to Chief Minister and say that our forecast is going to be right. And he said, but if it is wrong, I said, no, it won't be wrong. And ultimately, it turned out to be our forecast for better, because the kind of preparation which you need for 300 kilometer cyclone and 220 is quite different. So the accurate forecast, and this was acknowledged by none other than our Prime Minister Manmohan Singh. He said that our forecasts were better than the international agencies. So the reason is that the experience the ultimate forecaster has, and the local information which we have from our radars, from our buoys, is also equally critical deciding that what is likely to happen. So the ultimate forecast is always vetted by the human. They are experts. So there are many experts, and they will give you the correct forecast, like at local level or at different level. The the forecast is vetted by the human being. I mean, it is not that it's completely automation.
No.
Thank you, sir.
Any other question? Amit, please carry on.
Thank you, sir. So my question is a little more general. Given that climate change is having, impacting anomalies and creating anomalies in weather, the fact that we are able to now assess and give better predictions for regular changes in weather, does that also mean that we are able to, or will we be able to compute and predict these sporadic changes, these sudden changes that are happening, which are attributed mostly to climate change and its effects? Your views and thoughts on that, sir.
See, there are two separate things, you know. We know that because of the climate change, the frequency of, say, cyclone has increased, the frequency of hot days, cold nights have increased. As an individual event, the climate change is not going to make any difference as far as the prediction is concerned. Okay. What is changing is the frequency, intensity, those kind of things changes. And I think that is sufficient care has been taken into the models. Suppose inundation during cyclone. So what happens today and after 50 years would be different with the same intensity or same wind cyclone, because the sea level itself would have gone. But year to year, there is not much difference. It may be a couple of millimeters. So that way, it will not matter. But in the long term, it will matter. But those things are fairly well known. So I don't think there is any major change is needed in our overall system for forecasting.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Any other questions from non-NIAS members?
Yeah, actually, I don't see any non-NIAS members asking.
If there is no question, can I ask one question, sir?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. So I have actually two questions. One is, now we get prediction from both private agencies as well as government agencies. So how much reliable is the prediction from private agencies? The second question is, you said around 50 people will be developing the model and a mean is taken. So how do you people come to a consensus before the prediction is released?
Yeah, actually, see, there are two aspects. The basic, there are two kinds of agencies which picks up the basic model forecast, which is all the model forecast is also available by all meteorological agencies on that website. So you can simply download. It's not a big thing. So based on those forecasts, they try to arrive at certain decisions and then they give. Certain private players now also run their own models and they give the forecast. My experience is that some of the cases, the domain expertise is very critical. I think initially this question came from Arudra also. If you run a model at a very high resolution, that doesn't mean that your prediction is going to be more accurate if you have not understood the processes behind it. And so that is one thing. And the second is, how you interpret the information is also equally important. Now, what I have seen is that when the private agency gave information to solar power or a wind farm and all that, they were reasonably good because it based on the, but when they try to do their own, I don't think they have shown that they are able to do better than the existing government agencies. In anywhere, if you take NOAA or UMETSAT or UKMET office or IMD, the kind of information which they generate from end to end, right, from the observation, understanding, a lot of research is being done in understanding the processes and then the models. So if you take the model and keep on running it
without the backup of the research, I don't think it is going to sustain for a long time.
Any other question? Yeah. Sesha?
My question is that in the terms of the unpredictability, which is still associated with the models, because it ultimately comes down to predictions, then how do experts and scientists associated with prediction of the weather, they try to deal with the risk which is associated in making a prediction and dealing with the uncertainties?
Yeah, I mean, that's a very good question. See, there are two ways it is done, that we know about the uncertainty. So, let us take example of a monsoon. So, normally in the world over, there are three classes given, normal, below normal, or above normal. And in India, we have a different scale, that 95% or 90% or we. So, there is just some range. When we say normal, it has a plus minus, say, 4% or something like that. So, if you say 100%, it could be 96, it could be 104. So, the uncertainty which is there in the prediction is taken care by not giving only one number, but the range. And that error would normally fall between this range. So, that way it is taken care of. So that you must have seen that, like, short-term forecast, they say very heavy rainfall, that means above certain limit, or very heavy, it is 24 to 32. So there is a range everywhere. So probably with that, you would be able to address the uncertainty, because there is no other way. And in some of the cases, the uncertainty is very large. As the time period goes, the uncertainty also increases.
Thank you, sir.
Sister Kamin Singh.
Thank you, sir.
Any other questions? Okay. So if there is no questions, we are winding up. Thank you very much for finding time to attend the lecture. Please do let us know your opinion on how to improve the quality of our transmission and all that. If you are interested in some topics also, do let us know. We will try to arrange such lectures. Thank you very much. Thank you.